my name is Tina Kim. I was born and raised here in Houston, Texas, all my life. I was probably in a very worst situation where majority of my family, including all my uncles and aunts, my grandparents, are all here in Houston. My dad comes from a very large family of 12 siblings, and so we're very lucky that family dynamic where most of us are here. So I'm very used to having a lot of family present. In my childhood, everything to me was good. You know, like even if things were going on, if there's any kind of like drama going on, I was very naive to all of that. Fast forward, probably entering my college years was probably when life opened many new beginnings for me, meaning like understanding life from a very different perspective. Freshman year when I entered college, this was back in 2001 is when I started school. I had a cousin at that time who invited me to come check out his new bike, right? And I didn't think much of it. When I thought of the word bike, I thought of like ring, ring, like a bicycle, right? But when I came downstairs from my dorm, it was like a vroom, vroom, like motorcycle, bicycle, right? I didn't think any of it at that time. I went down, was like, okay, and then got on his bike. And within the first 10 minutes, we unfortunately got into a terrible motorcycle accident. We both got hit, and I didn't have a helmet on at the time, and I flew off the bike. And so my memory of that accident, actually, I don't remember. I think I just remember bright lights. But after that, I went unconscious, went to a trauma hospital. And then from there, my whole idea of life is unicorn and rainbows was completely flipped upside down. Mom had to start teaching me how to like walk again because my gait and mobility was completely compromised. She was feeding me again. She was bathing me again. You know, like all those kinds of things, right? So it was a very, very terrible accident to say the least. But what we weren't prepared for was not the physical recovery, but the mental and emotional recovery from there on. Going back to school and trying to navigate through all these unfamiliar emotions that I was starting to go through, I thought it was just me going through funny feelings of not knowing what this was, but I just had to deal with it. But I went to a very, very dark, dark place in my life where the idea of wanting to stay in this life just started to become something that I no longer wanted to be a part of anymore. And at that time, there was nobody to talk about it with. I remember at that time, I think someone had advised me to go speak with like a counselor, right? And I think it was the first time that she had mentioned the words, I think you're clinically depressed. And I remember getting very angry because that was a sign of I'm weak, you're not worthy. You know, it was just a very negative stigma, right, in my mind. And so I chose not to accept it. But the more that time went by and the more that I was unable to handle these kinds of unfamiliar emotions, I had to finally come to this realization that I was depressed. I was very, very depressed. And I think what's so hard about that is when people on the outside look at you, you look so normal, right? Like there aren't scars that are showing unless you engage in those kinds of like self-harm kind of things, but you just look so okay from the outside that your expectations from other people aren't met, and that's just when the clash starts happening. Whenever I went into that deepest, darkest moments, it's not something that's easy to share, but for me, it even went another step further where I got to a point where life was just so hard. It became so hard that at one point I finally was just like, I don't see the point of this anymore. I'm a burden to my parents. I'm a burden to society. I have no self-worth. If I'm just not here anymore, nobody else will have to take care of me. So I remember being in my room one night, and I was on a lot of pain medication. I was like curious if I took a lot of, if I took a little extra of this medication here. I don't know how much more I would have to take, but I knew if I took enough, maybe that would be the end of it. And then so I did try to OD on some of my medication with the hopes and prayers of I would just like go to sleep. And then I remember going into a long sleep, but then I also remember waking up. And I remember waking up and just being so sad because having to deal with another day of trying to mentally go through my worthlessness on this life, right? On this earth, was just too painful. I think one of the turning points for me was, I think I was just tired. I was tired of being so sad. You know, like I went through depression for years and years. And I mean, it was a very long journey, but I just remember sitting, I was like late at night, staring at a computer, and I just had this light bulb moment. And I was like, I've tried to take my life and it's not happening. I've done other stupid things and I'm still here. You know, if I'm not going to die, then I guess, well, dang, I'm here to live for something, right? And just this light bulb moment went off and my body was just physically exhausted. I remember calling my mom from school one day, and I think she could hear it in my voice. And I told her like I was tired and it was time for me to come back home. And for whatever reason, in that moment, I remember she gave me her credit card and was like, you're gonna book yourself a one-way ticket home. And I remember flying, getting on that plane, coming down to the pickup area. I remember her standing there and we just locked eyes. And even though I had never really talked to her too in depth about the depression and all the things I was going through, it's like she and I just knew, and we were able to just cry. And without many words, like she just gave me the warmest hug. And in that moment, I think for me, like, I didn't know what was going to happen next, but I knew it was going to be okay. And even though the depression was a journey to like overcome and get through, having her love and her strength in that moment to just not judge me and not let me feel like I was unworthy and any less of was like such a key moment, right? And it was something that I didn't expect from her because we had never talked about it. That motherly love and that gentle hug was like the such a huge crucial moment in my life to being able to just start seeing life for what it was. Now I'm a mother to two incredibly beautiful children. My idea of motherhood was like painted in this one way, right? But I'm actually a mother to a special needs child. My oldest son has autism. The first few years of transitioning into motherhood was a whirlwind. You know, when I found out that I was pregnant with my first child, I became a Pinterest mother. I started to pin all these things about how I was gonna decorate the room, how I was gonna raise my children, how I was gonna do activities every day. Like I became a Pinterest mother. So my expectations were set me up for failure, right? Because they were just off the roof. But the first few years of becoming a mother was wild. Our son was very spirited, according to Google, right? During his first year of life, it was fine. You know, he developed in a way where he met all these developmental needs and, you know, he was meeting all his milestones. But probably when he turned around 2 was when something just kind of changed. My son was in and out of several different daycares because essentially they were saying that he was too much to handle. I didn't know anything at that time. I never suspected anything was wrong with my son. I just expected he was just very wild, right? But after being in and out several different schools, we were actually advised to go just get him checked out just for peace of mind. And so my husband and I booked an appointment, and without expecting much, we were just pretty much expecting them to say he's just hyperactive, right? But after a long assessment period right then and there. I remember the physician just looked at us and was like, "Mom, Dad, your son has autism." And I was speechless. One, because I'm in the medical world and I never saw it myself. And then two, I just wasn't expecting it at all, right? And I remember my husband, he's rarely without words. He just completely went mute. And I knew he was in a state of shock when he heard those words. But I remember looking at my husband and I remember telling him, no matter what happens from here on out, you and I are gonna make this the best experience that we're gonna make of it. I mean, inside I was crying. I was like crying because I was grieving the idea of this isn't what I was expecting. My perfect child was no longer my perfect child. Not that I'm saying he's not perfect, but he was no longer the child that I expected it to be. And then two, I didn't know anybody else who had this. I didn't know anybody else who went through this. And I was scared. I was completely scared. And I didn't know if I was enough to be a mother to handle this kind of diagnosis that I was just so unfamiliar with. I remember we were like, we need to share this news with our family just so that we can start getting support and whatnot, right? Some of the feedback that we got when we shared this news was, one, my mother, and I know she said this with the greatest intent, you know, it was to, "Tina, don't share this online. Don't share this with social. Don't share this with anybody else." And at first I felt incredibly hurt. But looking back now, I knew she was sharing that because she didn't want people to judge us. She wanted to protect her daughter from having to suffer any more than what we were already going to go through, right? And I remember another comment that we were told was, "Maybe he's not autistic. Maybe it's just a reflection of poor parenting." And I remember in that moment, again, I, in my heart, choose to believe that those ideas were shared as a measure of protecting us. Because it was a matter of not wanting to come to the fact that this was our reality and this was our truth. I will tell you this, the first time I got that diagnosis, the first thought that I had to myself was, my child has to die before I do. Truthfully, because where we are today right now, the services really aren't set up to give him the fairest chance to be able to be successful. That's the reality. While he's young, I can be a parent and I can advocate and speak up as much as I need to. But as he grows up, there really isn't much. And it scares me to death having to think about, if I'm not here, then who's gonna love him the way that I love him? There is nobody else who will love him as much as I will love him. So, and especially Korean Americans speaking about a special needs child is just, it's unheard of. And I don't, it's taken a long time to come to this point, but I don't feel shame or embarrassed. I feel more of a need to talk more openly about it. We've been able to grow this community of support where if my son does one thing, you know, if he accomplishes trying a new food or if he accomplishes saying another word, you know, like, these people, there's actually a group of people that are like, go Adam, you know, we're all Team Adam, that's his name. I feel fortunate because I have been able to be surrounded by a group of friends and community who actually, I feel like they're going through this journey with us. I never want them to be able to feel like they have to feel sorry for us. That's not the point of it. I want them to be able to learn how to adapt and include us and also learn how to be compassionate towards us. And the fact that I'm able to do that with my friends and the fact that they don't look at me any differently has been such a blessing. And I feel like just through open communication and being able to just explain ourselves, right, to have this two-way open conversation is what allows us to be able to really integrate this typical family and the atypical family. And that's a journey that I'm still figuring out right now. When I kind of look back at a lot of the things that has happened in my life, I 100% believe my life experiences that I had to go through 20 years ago, starting with the accident, having to go through the mental depression and looking so normal on the outside, but dealing with everything in the head, it actually kind of reminds me of what I think my son is going through right now. On the outside, he looks completely normal, but it's all in his brain, right? It's a mental diagnosis that it's invisible and it's very hard for people to understand. Like, it's like almost as if I had to go through all of those moments and all of those pain so that I could be set up to be the mother that I need to be, to understand where he is currently, and to also understand in the future the kinds of pain, the kind of trauma, the kind of hardships that I know he will go through. And for him, he will go through many times where I know he will feel unheard and unseen, but because of my experiences, I'll be able to kind of walk hand in hand with him down that journey. My name is Tina Kim, and this is my Korean American story.